It's time now for St. Helens Town Talk Cafe with your host, Steve Toski. The opinions heard on this program are not necessarily those of KOHI Radio, staff, or advertisers. You can call in now at 503-397-1600. Now, here's Steve.
Something in addition to what we brought in. A piano and actually a piano player, and let's see if we can hear some of that. Here we go. Nice, huh? You guys like that stuff? Steinway? Nice, huh? It's 4 o'clock on a Friday. The regular crowd shuffles in. There's an old man sitting next to me. Hey, Marty, how you doing?
I'm good.
Making sure our signal's coming in. All right. Enough. So the person playing the piano. Oh, we better get our reverb. We better be getting in our soundproof room. So we're gonna. There we go. So our piano player today is Danny Sternadel, Riverboat.
Danny. Riverboat Danny.
Riverboat Danny.
That's what I'm known as.
And I met Danny at the Klondike, and he was playing piano.
Yes, he does.
He was so patient, he let me sing, and I could tell you.
I remember that now.
I know.
Let's say there was a little bit of adult beverage involved.
Yes.
Yep.
The complaint jar overflowed after that. Piano player, great. Don't let the dude sing from the bar again. And so Kim is here. Welcome, Kim.
Hello.
Thank you so much for coming today to help manage the place. And our special this afternoon is, what is the special, Kim? I don't even know what it is.
It's clam chowder.
Clam chowder.
It's Friday.
Friday, it's clam chowder day. Delicious.
It's cold outside, it's rainy, so it's perfect.
See, I didn't even know the special. Thank God I've got the manager to help us out.
It's a fishy day.
It's a fishy day. And so, you know, Danny, I ran into Danny, and he's a great piano player, and I thought, let's bring Danny into the cafe and hear a little bit about his life story. Since that's what we do here on the Town Talk Cafe. We meet our neighbors, our wonderful town, our fabric of St. Helens. And so, Danny, do you live, around here, or are you just traveling through?
Well, a man's home is where he sets his butt, and I am sitting here in St. Helens, so this is my home.
Yes.
But yes, I have an interesting story. So a lot of people ask, when did you start playing the piano? Well, I was 6 years old.
Okay.
Across the street was this lady, Mrs. Borman. She was 90 years old, and my mom sent me over there at 6 years old to learn how to play the piano. And after about 6 months, I said, the heck with this. I don't want to do this anymore. But I kept tinkering around with it. And then when I turned 13 and some girls heard me play the piano, I said, Mom, I want to take piano lessons again.
This is my
okay, really?
So
a lot of guys pick up the guitar for that very reason.
Oh, no, yes, exactly. No, I had the piano. So Mom says, well, go see Mrs. Borman. Well, she was 112 now. And she was very old, and she sits down and she says, well, look, do you want to learn how to be a professional musician or how to have fun? And I said, I want to meet girls. And she goes, you want to have fun.
Yes, okay.
So there I am at 13 years old with Mrs. Borman, her hand shaking and all this. And it's embarrassing to say, but she taught me how to cheat. So I really can't read music. She taught me some basic, those musicians out there will know the 1-4-5 type of classic rock type of stuff. And she taught me how to do that and just make stuff up like this. So that's how I ended up playing the piano.
And all right. So it reminds me of, there are so many images that we have of the piano player, that is in the bar playing the piano, and as a bar frequenter, I could tell you I really enjoy it when there's somebody playing music there. Mm-hmm. And you know, I'm reminded of a famous line: of all the gin joints in all the towns in the world, she walks into mine. Of course, that's Rick, you know, about
Casablanca.
That's Rick talking about, that's correct. But all the gin joints in the world, and I, do you play the gin joints of the world, Danny?
I have played the beer joints of the Columbia River.
Okay, all right.
There's a couple of those.
Yeah.
And there are many of those. And so the way I got the name Riverboat Danny is when I first moved here in 2015, I said, all right, I want to do something with music. So I got on my boat and I went across the river to Ridgefield. And there was a Sportsman Inn over there, Sportsman's Lodge. And the owner, and I walked in, I said, hey, you got a grand piano. Can I play it? And it was the afternoon. So I went down there and, you know, did like maybe a piano man or something. And this guy comes shooting out from the upstairs. And he comes down and he comes up to this rail and he looks at me and he goes, you, stay there. So he comes running down the stairs and he goes, I own this place. You're pretty good. How much you charge? And I said, $100. And he goes, you're fired.
Oh, wow.
You got your first gig, your first audition, and didn't quite get there.
Well, no, I did. And he said, you know, that's a little bit high. And I says, well, look, if you just give me a burger and a tip jar and a beer, I'm good. And he goes, all right, can you play Tuesday, Thursday, Friday?
There so you go.
Dinner every day.
So I was playing over there quite a bit, and I actually had a hat, and I put some cards in it, and would wear a black shirt with a garter around the sleeve, and just, you know, and he had this upright piano, kind of an old funky thing, mm-hmm. and right behind me are a couple of pool tables. And I would just sit in there and do my thing, just play whatever songs I wanted to. They really liked, like, Rawhide, and it was like the Blues Brothers types of things. And they're having a ball behind me, drinking and hooting and hollering. And so that was how I got the name Riverboat Danny.
How long ago was that? Just
this is 8 years ago.
Okay.
8, 9 years ago.
And were you living in the local area then?
Yeah, I had moved to St. Helens in 2015.
Okay.
And shifted from, I used to have horses. My life was down in the Corvallis area, in the Eugene area, and I got too old for horses. They kept breaking my bones. So I figured when we move up here, I will shift away from horses and find some other hobby.
I know you actually, I've seen you on the river. You actually have a boat out there. I've seen you on your boat.
I do, and it's great. My wife loves it. Danny, isn't it time for you to go play across the river?
There you go.
Don't you think it's time to take your boat to Astoria to play? Yes, honey, you're right.
Absolutely. Road trip.
How often does, you know, I've run into you a few times playing at the Klondike. And, Kimmy, how often do you guys have Danny in there, just out of curiosity?
Once a month, usually.
Okay.
I think we have you scheduled for this month, don't we?
Yes, you do. In fact, if you guys really want a good show, on Saturday, December 23rd.
That's when it is.
The day before Christmas Eve.
Mm-hmm.
Come on down and ponder your family. Have a few drinks. Ponder your family some more. Have a few drinks. Because you're going to see your family the next evening.
Oh, yeah.
Isn't there going to be some kind of special? As I recall, isn't there going to be a special eggnog or something going
on?
Oh,
we already have eggnog on the menu.
But I think,
yeah.
Didn't we talk
yeah,
about
Yeah, we did with Jen Massey.
There you go.
The easy on the noggin, toasted pecan simple syrup that Chelsea makes me.
There you go.
She's one of the cooks in the kitchen. She's talented.
Who normally sings when he's... Do you sing, Danny? When
Nobody sings.
Really?
It's just a piano.
Just a piano, yeah. Although on a couple of occasions. So Steve came up and sang
Yeah, it
once.
Depends on who's there.
Yes, I sang once. And then they said, we'll buy you drinks if you just stop.
And they said they'll buy me more drinks if I can make him stop.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, I know.
You guys weren't supposed to tell each other that. Supposed to be, you know.
But there was one night I was playing, and this young woman, about 30, 35, comes up, and she goes, oh, you're so good. And I said, well, thank you very much. And she goes, do you mind if I sing a song with you? And I said, okay. So, and she actually had a really great voice, and she sang a couple of songs. We didn't have a microphone for her, so you probably didn't hear her in the other area.
Yeah.
So, but she was really good, and she was so excited, like, oh, my gosh, do you want to do something? And I go, hey, anytime. You know, you want to come down here? I know the owners, and, you know, you can play. And she goes, yeah, I'd love that. And I said, where do you live? And she goes, Sisters. And I go, well, that's a bit of
mackerel.
A commute.
That's a big one.
A little bit.
Did you go to Sisters and play there so you guys could sing?
I have played in Sisters, and I actually...
Where have you played in Sisters?
I didn't look at her. So there's a bar in Sisters, the Sisters Bar and Grill.
Yeah.
Played there.
You didn't look her up when you went in there?
No. I'm just more of a drifter.
But hey, you're on the riverboat.
Where it takes you. Where the river takes you.
And where are some of the rougher places that you played? I mean, I got to think you've been in some
like
places.
Like a hole-in-the-wall type place?
Yeah, hole-in-the-wall, dive bars.
So.
Do they have pianos in dive bars?
I should hope so. I could tell you, I've been in a few with pianos in them. And,
really?
Oh, yeah.
And they are out of tune. And there's usually a note or two that doesn't work.
Ooh, that's a fun challenge, though.
And it is fun. So then you're working around going, oh, I can't play a B-flat because that's so out of tune. Where do I play it?
You know, where have you played around, though? I mean, it was Sisters and the Klondike. And give us some other places. Astoria, it sounds like you go there.
Oh, I play Astoria quite often. In fact, I've kind of settled into I play... Two places are my favorites, the Bridgewater Inn in Astoria, and it's a very fancy restaurant, beautiful high-end place, beautiful view of the river right under the bridge.
Oh, how nice.
And it's got this grand piano in there. It's called Bridgewater Bistro.
Huh.
And I don't know if you guys have been there, there's the cannery on the that looks out. There's a really high-end hotel. And just inside from that is this Bridgewater Bistro with this grand piano. And I get dressed up. I mean, you know, I don't dress up for the Klondike.
Yeah, we're pretty, we're casual.
Yeah.
Very comfortable with the Klondike.
We want you guys to all feel comfortable with whatever you're in.
Marty, can you remember to send the Bridgewater a bill for the free advertising?
I'm working on the invoice right now.
Thanks.
Okay. I thought I heard typing over there.
I've been there. In fact, I've met the owners, so they're good people.
Yep.
And then
Tony and Ann.
What's the other place in Astoria?
Yeah.
What's the other place in Astoria?
So the other place I played is a place called T. Paul's, and that's another high-end restaurant right in town. And that's really about it in Astoria because that's when I started to tone down. I was playing too much, and I wanted to tone down and just do stuff I wanted to do and have fun.
Yeah.
And so the Astoria gig, they get me a hotel. And I stay there, so I go down there and play Friday and Saturday night. So on New Year's weekend, if you want to go to Astoria, I'll be playing the Friday and Saturday before New Year's.
Where and which place is that?
That's at the Bridgewater Bistro in Astoria.
And they have a place to stay there?
Next door to it is something called the Riverwalk Inn.
Oh, yeah.
And so they get me a room there for every night that I play, and I play there once a month, and... It's just a lot of fun. It's good for the soul. You get up in the morning, you can watch the ships coming in.
Yeah, I love watching those big ships.
So if you're thinking of something else for New Year's and you don't have anything in town, you decide to go to the Riverwalk Inn, get a place, and what's the name of the place again?
The Bridgewater Bistro.
Do you have to buy tickets?
To see me? Of course you do.
Of course, I know. We get on StubHub. So I have a very serious question, though, Kim, and that is Danny's been playing at the Klondike and bringing people a lot of joy.
Yes.
And he says, we hear now, at least there's Sisters and has gone to Astoria for almost a regular gig. He's been in St. Helens since 2015. Is he a local yet?
I would say so, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Hello, Marty. Marty.
I think he can feel like one.
I was talking to Danny about that before we did the show.
Wow. I feel like if you contribute to your community in any type of way, that it kind of makes you part of the community. So
there you go.
I say yes.
I like that.
But I'm very welcoming to a lot of people. It's just my nature to be welcoming. But I think that if you put any type of effort into your community or do things to help... entertain people.
I think it
makes you a part of the community.
I play Avamere quite often, about every
few months.
They
love that.
It is great, and there's an emotional connection that happens. And unfortunately, I'm getting to the age group where they come up and they go, "My kids really love that song." And I'm playing classic rock stuff.
So, nice. See, I thought, you know, I'm glad to hear that at least if you, what is that, 15, was it 8 years? If you're here for 8 years, 9 years, and you contribute,
I don't know, is that the number? Is that the number you have to?
I don't know. I've been here for like 4 years now. It's getting to be 4 years, and you know, I don't think that you're qualified yet. You know, even if you've caught a few fish, and you know, you sing. I sang at the Klondike once, not well, but that's not enough contribution. But I'm glad to hear that there is a time frame.
I'm likening what Kim said.
Yeah, I think
that, you know, if you contribute, and you, Steve, my friend, I have seen you contribute just a small amount of time.
This is your home. This is your base. This is where you are living and doing all your things. So I feel like you are part of the community, yes.
And I think
that's
Steve
my final answer.
Well, thank you.
I do, too. I wasn't going to argue that, but I think that as well, because it's like...
I'm making application. You know, it's
when you get a billboard.
You know, when you have a billboard with your face on it.
I think that really brings you in.
See, I think so, too. It's like, you know,
yes,
can't get rid of that.
I know. Face for radio is definitely right there on for everybody's enjoyment. So Danny, I got to think, though, on being in bars and where people are imbibing. Yeah, I mean, have you ever been anywhere where just some stuff has gone down that you want to share?
Are you talking about him breaking up bar fights playing on the piano in the background?
Let me tell you a story, and it was on the Columbia River, and it was not in Ridgefield, but it was in another place. I was going to say Kathlamet, but did I say that?
No.
No.
So I'm playing a piano, and it's a beat-up piano with a couple of notes missing. And I do my Riverboat Danny with the hat and the cards and all this. And my back is to the pool tables that are behind me. And I'm playing along, and they're just having a blast. And of course, they're drinking quite a bit. And then all of a sudden, I hear this crack. And somebody got really upset about some playing and hit a guy with the pool cue broken. Didn't hit him in the head. Otherwise, you know, I don't know if you've ever been in a fist fight, but they're not like the movies. In a fist fight, it's two swings and the fight's over.
Yeah.
You know, the movies, they go on for hours.
The whole bar is in a brawl in the movies.
Right.
And people are, you know, breaking things, chairs, and people
just
manage to stand up and keep going.
And that is... That is what happened at this place, was a heck of a lot of belly bucking and beers being thrown.
Belly bucking.
Yeah. They
I like that word.
They were getting quite angry. So I just kept playing the piano because I didn't want them to be hitting me.
Yeah, your job is...
Just say, hey, boys.
Your job as a piano player is to keep playing. And then do you have
the music at that point.
I want to hear your piano music when the fight's breaking out. Can you give us that? Let's see your go-to on, you know, in case here at the cafe, you know, who knows? People
might
start
be
throwing
some chaos.
Food. We could have a food fight in here
pie
one time.
Pie fight.
Yeah. And so we got the pie fight going, boom.
Yeah.
And you start hitting, what's the piano music that's going on?
So, if it's a very athletic group, I'll do something
athletic,
like this.
Depending on the people.
There we go.
All right, boys.
Throw the punches. All right. Take this piece of pie. Take that one.
Put on a banana peel or something.
Smack them upside the head. And what if the gunshots are going off? What, you know, the people start shooting. You know, don't shoot the piano player. What do you play when the guns are shooting?
Then you've got to calm the place down.
Bang, 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 bang.
That note's terrible.
Bang, bang. Oh, that's hilarious. Now that's good. So if it's kind of a robust fight, people are really going at it.
Yeah.
You got one, and then have you ever been at where people have been shooting in the?
So I was telling Marty earlier, I played in a lot of bands down in the Eugene area when I used to live down there. And this is true story. I'm not going to use any names. But I was in this band. We're going to be playing one of those bars in downtown Eugene. And I, you know, I'm a kind of a goody-two-shoe guy relative to some of the stuff that's there. Well, the band didn't show up. And, you know, I'm set my piano up, and the band doesn't show up. I'm like, what's going on? So I talked to the owner of the place, and he goes, what are you doing here? And I said, well, you know, we had a gig tonight. And he goes, your band leader was murdered.
Oh, my goodness. Holy mackerel. Was this before texting?
Before any social media?
Well, so that's the gigs we played before that. I can understand how this had played out. A drug deal went bad on this guy, and he was murdered by the dealer.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow.
And it's like, I started thinking to myself, I'm not sure this is the life for me. So I started shifting over into more solo work after that.
Yeah.
Not just playing with any band.
Just anybody, just at any
Smart.
Time. So if I were to just ask you, let me just try and just think of some things that I would want to know. Well, it's Christmas time. Can you? How about Linus and Lucy? Can you get Linus and Lucy?
Linus and Lucy.
Yeah, Linus and Lucy.
Like peanuts?
On the piano.
You mean there's something that goes like this?
Yeah.
Uh huh. That's the one.
Keep going. I'm putting up our Christmas decorations.
I want Christmas cookies.
I know. That's it. We're getting the Christmas decorations going up. Dancing up. Oh, my goodness. People are dancing. People are getting up out of their seats and dancing in the cafe. Oh, my God.
Even the babies.
Okay. We got to get them to eat, though. So how about, let's do one, how about Edmund Fitzgerald? I mean, that's just an obscure thing. When the legend lives on from the Chippewa down, the big chip they don't get
changed. That's it.
That big chip never gets up.
I feel like I'm at the restaurant right now.
November, I love that song. It's a good one.
Are they still serving turkey? You know what? Turkey should be our year-round food.
It just seems like it's too... I had a turkey.
Well, guess what? It can be.
You
have the opportunity for turkey every day. You do. It's there in the store.
Yeah. Do whatever you want. Yeah. Go buy the turkey every day.
That's right. Nobody's depriving
no.
you.
No.
I would be a much bigger man if there was turkey and gravy every day.
Yes.
Danny, are you putting Christmas lights on your boat down at the marina
when they
do the Christmas ships and stuff this year?
I'm involved with some of the Christmas ships activity.
Oh, cool.
I joined a boat club down there. And, in fact, this year my wife and I are supposed to go on a Christmas ship.
Ooh, that's fun.
That cruises around. We haven't quite pulled that together yet.
Yeah.
This year you're going to get on a Christmas ship?
Next weekend, isn't it?
Christmas ship for a dinner cruise.
Oh, fun.
And so I'll be waving at you from the shore.
Well, wait a minute. So are you going to go on one of the ships that's all lit up and
yes.
driving around?
Yes, yes.
Wow. I can say this. I do watch from the shore. I don't go out there and... It's really dark.
It's cold.
Yeah, I mean, how do they not crash into each other?
They all have
out there?
Lights on them.
I don't know. It's okay. Maybe they. I'm worried about that a little bit.
It's a little known. There actually is a submarine down there. That is coordinated.
It's on a track.
It's coordinating.
So, speaking of watching the Christmas ships, how about sitting on the dock of the bay? I mean, what if it feels sometimes? Okay, that's right. How about the Sting? Can you do the Sting?
The Sting? I think the real name of that is The Entertainer, but everybody knows it as The Sting.
Eat the clam chowder, bring it in, put it in your mouth, and take a dip.
Take a dip.
So tell us, though, I mean, do you ever see romance blooming? Kim, let me ask you that question. I mean, at the Klondike, you know, Danny's playing the piano, and do you ever see that romance blooming there as the music is tinkling?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's a great place for date night. Oh. And breakups. We have great cocktails to remedy that.
The breakups,
yeah.
Sometimes the cocktails are the cause of the breakup.
Yeah. Sometimes they help with the breakup as well. So, you know, we're there for any occasion.
How about a story? You got any stories with, you know, like at all the gin joints in the world, she had to walk into mine, and here you're playing the piano, and just, you know, the romance starts to happen around you, Danny. You
There's
got
just
any
hearts floating through the air.
Yes.
Well, there is, I work with various singers, and I was working. That's an email I got. That dog barks whenever I get an email.
Okay.
I heard that dog bark.
Well, it's okay.
Like, is there a dog in here?
Dogs are allowed at the cafe.
I'm so confused.
So.
Marty's looking at the ceiling like, where did that come from?
So I'm playing at this singer in one of the bands I was in. It was just her and I, and I was simplifying things. And we're up playing at a place called Odell Lake Lodge. So it's a mountain resort up on Highway 58, heading up towards top of the Cascade Mountain Range. Beautiful lake. And this woman has this really sensuous, romantic voice, and it's great. And I said, yeah, you want to come up and do a gig? So she does. So she comes up, and she sings, and it's a very intimate bar type of arrangement. And she does a moon dance. And I think she knocked it through the park. This lady stands up, walks up there and goes, "You ruined my favorite song."
Oh, really?
And this poor woman.
I didn't expect that to happen.
I didn't. And the woman, she's a great singer. She was about 28 at the time. She just started crying.
Oh, my God. You People know? Are too harsh.
Exactly.
If it wasn't, who does that song originally?
I bet she's still hurt by that moment.
Who's the moon dancer person that does that?
Van Morrison.
Van Morrison. If it's not Van Morrison, I don't want anybody to sing it.
Right, exactly.
It doesn't matter. No cover. No covers allowed.
That's all I do.
I you know, I would sing that song, except for I don't really want anybody to hate on me like that. You know, the lines are open. If anybody wants to ask Danny some questions, I have a question for you about your horses. What's your background in horses? And I know Kim's interested in that too.
Horses.
You love horses?
I like horses. Yes.
So there was a time in my life that I had a 45-acre ranch, and had a half dozen horses. Well, actually seven. So that's a little more than a half dozen.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. It's a baker's half dozen.
And I was outside of Corvallis, living up there for a while. And that's pretty much where I raised the family out there. And horses are, to me, one of the most magical, mystical animals. And, you know, there's horse therapy groups out there.
Yeah.
And people that are handicapped. And there is this, you know, the emotions that I have in music. It's really all I'm doing is sharing my E factor, my emotions when I'm playing music. And somehow a horse just connects. And whenever you're riding a horse or on a horse, it's just phenomenal. So I have not ridden a horse since I moved up here.
Wow.
And to St. Helens.
Okay.
I was living down in the Eugene area.
All right.
Out in the sticks. Actually, way out in the sticks.
45 acres in the sticks. Did you ride horses there?
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, picture it. Are you like a, you know, you had seven horses. I mean, are you riding them by yourself? Are you out there with a group? Are you posse? Or what's going on there?
Anyway, we had guns. No. So it was
that kind of posse.
So Boy Scout groups would come out, and we'd take them out, Girl Scout troops, and we'd go for rides. And I had a set
cool.
of friends, and we would go horse camping a lot. I once went and lived up in the top of the Cascades. My brother had died when he was 51, and I had, you know, gone through caretaking and helping everybody through that. And about two or three years later, I had a, you know, kind of like this, I just need a breakdown. I just need to get away. So I took a couple horses, went and lived up on a lake on the top of the mountains for a month by myself on this little island. and just rode horses all over the
place. That was your therapy.
That was my therapy.
Yeah.
Wow.
I brought 10 cases of beer and 2 cases of wine and ran out. So
I was going to ask, did you have any left?
No, I had to come home because I ran out of beer.
Yeah, you guess it's time.
Kim, do you ride horses at all? Or is that
well, I grew up around them. One of my best friends growing up, she was rodeo queen. But I haven't ever really had my own. I love riding horses. I've taken my daughter riding on the beach, too. She wanted to do that when, like, I think it was for her 9th birthday. She's like, I want to go ride a horse on the beach. So I, like, called Long Beach in Washington. They had horse rides. Back then it was, like, $25 a person, and you just go ride for an hour or two on the beach. It was so much fun. So we've done that a couple times, but...
I know some people with some horses you could ride, you and your daughter.
In
town.
Yeah.
We could arrange for that. Danny, would you be interested to ride now, or have you hung up your reins?
So I thought
that was good.
I reached that one.
You were proud of yourself on that one, too. Damn. Tell on your face. You were like, that was good.
So speaking of sisters, so I haven't ridden, and I was in Sisters last year up in Camp Sherman. And I decided I would go and rent a horse for an hour. Well, you can't rent a horse for an hour. You have to go on the ride, you know, on the tour.
I just wanted to stand here and pet him. Can I just smell him?
I love the smell of horses, too.
So the gal looked at me and goes, you're an old guy. Yeah, okay, we'll put you on this. So I did go on the tour, and they said, you can't get off the horse, you know, and you got to stay on it. So I got on the horse, and... I know what I'm doing. I mean, I know horses really well. And we get about halfway through the ride, and I say to the wrangler in front, you know, the lady leading us, and I go, I'm an old guy. I got to pee. And she goes, well, you're not supposed to get off the horse. And I gave her the look. And she goes, okay. So I jumped off the horse and ran around and then helped her.
I don't want too much information, by the way. I think,
end of story.
I know. Where are we going with this, Danny?
Where we're going with this is to be back in the saddle again, literally, it brought tears to my eyes. The smells, the sound of the saddle.
Oh, the leather.
The leather.
I love that sound, too. Yeah.
Yeah.
The creaking it makes.
And the horses sweating. You know, we did do a little bit of cantering and got the horses up to speed. And it was like, oh.
Just the feeling.
So I've vowed myself to go on a horseback ride once a year. If you have an opportunity here in town, I'm in.
Okay. All right. Go with Kim. Well, I was advised not to ever get on a horse by some people. I said, I always had a dream. Yeah, you know, I've ridden the horses a little bit, and I said, I've always had a dream of doing it. And both the old guys said to me, "Now you're too old. Everyone gets thrown, and you're going to break.
You should try it.
All right.
You should try it.
Okay, we're going to do
it. Especially if
one.
You want to be a local, Steve.
I know. I'm applying. Okay, I can put that in there. Okay, fish, horseback ride check.
I'm shaking my finger at you.
I'm already
went fishing, so you're good there.
I know.
Let's do the horseback
I'm contributing,
thing.
Trying to contribute.
Back to the community.
So, okay, so then, Danny, though, what is your next gig? What do you have coming up?
Well, I already mentioned Bridgewater, and I mentioned
the old Klondike.
And that's pretty much, actually, there's another one. This is a fun story. So I'm playing at Bridgewater about 2 years ago. And I do my set, and there's always interesting people. I got to tell you, hell, I met you through music.
That's true.
In a way,
very
I kind of met you through,
yeah,
through music.
Yeah, it's true. Mm-hmm.
And so I'm sitting out there, and I finished my set, and this guy walks up to me, an older gentleman, and he goes, you're pretty good. And I go, well, thank you very much. And he goes, I got a jazz band in Portland, and our piano player grew too old to play anymore. Do you want to do it? And I said, well, I don't play jazz. And he goes, that's all right.
Okay.
What's he wanting you to play? I'm
so
confused.
I know I'm trying to.
So here's what happens. So he plays the drums, and there's a bass player. And he's like 75, and the bass player's like 78. And they're both attorneys, big-name attorneys, and do all this well. And so we go, and we rehearse. And I'm all nervous, like, oh, I don't know any jazz. And so what they said is just do what you usually do. So I just did. And they just started chiming in. So now we call ourselves the River City Trio. We got rid of the jazz out of there because I don't play jazz. And we're playing, we've played at the Forestry Center by the zoo. We've played at, we're going to be playing at the Spaghetti Factory on December 10th, I think it is. And we just got through last weekend or a couple weekends ago playing a gig for Phelps Winery in Hood River.
Ooh, we just started carrying some Phelps wine.
Mm-hmm. Hey, I know the people personally.
So I grew up with some Phelps in Hood River, and I was wondering if I knew them too. And that's actually one of the reasons why I chose the wine, because I was like, I think I know them.
When are they coming to town next? We got this. Sounds like something we gotta. When the Phelps folks come in, we gotta get them. Danny's gonna play, and we're gonna have a little
Wine tasting, wine piano tasting. Playing, yeah. Pair some food with that.
Yes, and that, you know, segue into the potential of this community.
Yeah.
Those types of things need to happen all the time.
Yeah.
I mean, and yes, I know they're kind of yuppie-ish, or they're kind of maybe not the the rough-and-tumble bar scene that sometimes St. Helens has a notion of, but that's a shift.
Yeah.
And I think a natural segue.
Mm-hmm.
For the town. So,
well, it sounds like fun. I mean, we get the winery people in, and we pair it up, and we... You know them, and it just sounds like a nice segue. So when it happens, we'll make sure we announce it here on Town Talk Cafe,
sure.
And get it going. And if they can't, if it can't happen in the cafe, it can happen in the Klondike.
Yeah.
So so how about Maybe I'm Amazed? Can you play that too?
That actually is a very fun song.
It's a great song.
Karaoke.
Maybe I'm amazed at the way you love me all the time.
I can't top that.
Maybe I'm a fan of the way I love you. Maybe I'm amazed at the way you pulled me out of time. Pulled me on. All right, enough McCartney. That's a great tune. How about Let It Be? Can you Let It Be?
Although I do sing this to my daughter in the car because her nickname is B.
Come on.
So I always say Let It Be, and then I stare at her.
Well, so I have to segue a little bit into some promotions that are going to be coming up. So we're going to be doing hats, and we're going to be doing stickers.
Not hoodies?
Hoodies.
Yes.
No, that's for money. You don't have to buy them. Maybe we'll give away a couple hoodies, but... We're gonna go to hats, stickers. So watch out, because you could be getting a Town Talk Cafe sticker at any time in the future.
That's
and the
exciting.
Hats, and the hats are gonna be St. Helens for a Brighter Future hats. So we're gonna be doing that too. St. Helens for a Brighter Future hats, and we're gonna be doing giveaways on the show.
Absolutely.
Yes. So the idea is that. We're trying to bring in listeners so that people actually listen to the show. And, if you call in and you're the 10th caller or whatever, you get a hat. If you can, say something.
We might have to do, like, the third caller.
The third caller? the 42nd caller.
I'd be happy with the first caller.
I was being nice.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, thanks, Marty.
But what you're doing, you know, the ranch thing is fascinating me. Like, what led you to the 47-acre ranch, Riverboat Danny?
Well, it was, it's embarrassing. But here, I'm going to give it to you in a nutshell.
Okay. They pay me to ask embarrassing questions. Go ahead.
Ben Cartwright was my hero. When I was a kid, Ben Cartwright was everything. So there he is with Bonanza, and he's a good guy. You know, running a ranch, and And he had horses.
That's right.
And so
Ponderosa.
So yeah. So you know, it subliminally, it was like when I grow up, that's what I want to do.
Okay.
And life was very good to me and fortunate, and I was able to actually do the ranch thing. Of course, it all fell apart in the end, but you know.
Well, you still got to do what you wanted.
Exactly.
Yeah, you lived the dream.
Mark that off your list.
I lived that dream.
Yeah.
And next, it's being on the river in a boat, playing the piano.
Thank you, Kim.
You're welcome.
That exactly describes.
And you're,
sorry,
and
I don't mean to tell your story for you.
So you can't, you know, like Marty was telling me, he's been in the radio business a long time. I mean, it's a great, fulfilling thing to do. And I've been playing the piano. So you find this thing that you hang on to that carries you through, and you go on these other adventures. So music is my rudder, but, you know, there was a ranch, there was being a computer geek, there was being a piano player. I actually did some CASA work for a while, and I don't know if anybody's familiar with CASA.
Yes. In fact, Andrew, who is a beekeeper, was on the show. He's actually getting trained to do CASA right now.
Very intense stuff. Very yes. Serious. And I did that for 7 years down in the Eugene area. And
that's a child advocate, court child advocate.
Yes.
For those who don't know what that is.
Exactly. And so essentially what it is in the courtroom, they have the attorney representing the mother, the attorney representing the father, and the attorney representing the kid. And as a CASA, you're just looking over all the best situations. So in the legal world, you know a lot about the legal world. It's you're working on your client. And a CASA, because there's a kid involved, is kind of an overview of the whole thing. And he could say things to the judge that maybe the attorneys can't say.
I think it's one of the things in the law that actually works because you, unfortunately, the parents sometimes are wrapped up in some things. They got their own motivations going. And you have an independent person that really is paid to assess and to try to bring forward what is in the best interest of the child.
Absolutely. And I'm embarrassed to say this. I thought I was a pretty tough guy, that I could handle anything, but I emotionally could not handle the realities of parents putting cigarettes out on their kids. And the cases that I had were so horrific that if you brought that story to Hollywood, nobody'd believe it.
Yeah, I think that people don't fully understand, you know, people live in a bubble, but when you see the capability of what people are capable of, and it's interesting, we're talking about on Brady's show this morning about, you know, treating people humanely, and sometimes when you say, oh, the humanity, you got to remember that we as human beings, a lot of people do some stuff that is really over the line, the humanity.
And that separation between the media and the movies and the Hollywood and reality sometimes gets blurred, I think. And whenever you're faced with humanity, here's the way I described it. I moved to Eugene, became a CASA, and I decided, do not learn a community through its intestines.
Okay. That sounds like good advice. Kim, what do you think?
Yeah, I'm going to write that
one down.
I don't know,
but being in the restaurant business, that sounds really, frankly...
I think that's a bumper sticker.
Yeah, I know. You got to get to the stomach, though. Is that an intestine? I don't know about that.
So I learned a lot. When I came up here, they really wanted me to do more CASA work, and I emotionally just couldn't do it. I had to, and my wife and I did it together down in Eugene, and it's one of the most profound good things that we've done in our lives, but it's also probably the hardest.
That's why I'm getting out of the litigation practice. I got about 2 more years. I just can't handle the humanity. It keeps rolling. I gotta give it over to the younger folks to have a little more resilience.
That's right. Then we hang out at the Klondike, play the piano, have a drink.
That's right. Sing and
forget about all
that's right.
Your worries.
Was it forget about life for a while? Oh, Marty, I thought you had the harmonica in there. Come on, baby. I'm going to get him. All right, he's getting it out. So I do want to ask, well, Marty's getting his instrument ready there.
Yes.
Thank you. There it is. There's an old man sitting next to me.
There it is. Wow, that's good. Bringing the Friday night entertainment.
Oh, my goodness. Somebody just put $20. The tip jar, Mark.
That was amazing.
$20. Isn't that good?
I was telling that man behind the piano, it's been how many years
that
since
guy
I
over
picked
there.
Up a drumstick or a bass guitar or a harmonica?
We're getting the band back together again.
That's it. One, maybe two nights.
So how, you know, you said you were just a brief snapshot. I mean, you're a guy who's, you know, you said you were fortunate. How'd you make the loot? No comment? Come on. We ask tough questions here on Town Talk. People got to know your backstory, baby.
Well, what was the cash flow that caused all this to happen?
I just said the loop.
You said cash flow.
So, I adored Ben Cartwright, and I adored computers.
Okay.
So, when I got a degree from in computer science, in 1981, so I was there in the beginning of the heyday that's out there now, and did a lot of really geeky stuff.
Where were you when you did that geeky stuff?
I was with Hewlett Packard, and
in the garage.
changing oil in Bill and Dave's car. Yeah. Actually, I have met both of them. And probably the best story I have is meeting Bill Hewlett. So there was this little plane that used to fly back and forth. And one day I was going to get on the plane to take it down to another site. And this older gentleman walks up to me and he goes, "Hey, Sterney." And I go, "The guy knows my name." And that's my nickname. And it is on my name tag. And he goes, "Hey, Sterney." And I go, "God, that's Bill Hewlett." And he goes, "Do you know where the bathroom is?" I said, "Well, yeah, it's right over there." So I've had a very deep, intimate conversation with
you. Answered a really important question.
Yes. He needed you, and you came through.
I did.
An employee!
You answered the HP, right? You got questioned directly by the H.
Yeah,
the
and to have words come out of your mouth.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
And I didn't even stutter.
So were you in Silicon Valley then?
No, I never was in Silicon Valley.
Where were you working?
My turf was, here's the worst thing you can do. When I graduated college and I went to work for Hewlett Packard, it just cracked me up. I was in the field. I was an engineer in the field. So whenever my turf was Sacramento, Lake Tahoe, Reno, Carson City, and Redding. So I just hung out in that area, spent a lot of time skiing. My accounts were like City of South Lake Tahoe.
Well, that's rough, buddy.
Hell yeah.
I know. Go ahead. I'm wondering, where did you trip to end up in Eugene? But go ahead. I was asking you how you got the loot. Keep going.
So in a nutshell, at a point, life just moved on, and I had kids.
Okay.
And once I had kids, I said, you know, I need to leave the field, and left the field and went into the labs and was doing research and development and computer geek stuff. And then ended up in Corvallis and worked there for many years. And
the ranch was in Eugene.
And the ranch was in Corvallis.
Corvallis.
Corvallis, right.
Okay.
And then life took some twists and turns, and I ended up in Eugene. And now here I am in St. Helens, just having a blast.
And you and I, you know, kind of cross paths at the bar.
Yeah.
And And so now, Kim, I have another serious question for you, because I asked you before about. So you heard now, Danny, Riverboat Danny, at one point was in California, mm-hmm. and Nevada, mm-hmm. and he was in computers,
mm-hmm.
and then he came to Oregon, and now he's living here in St. Helens. Now, can he still be, even though he's from California, damn it, and has computer loot? Can he still be considered a local? That's the question. That's a deep question.
You're asking like someone who's not a local, Steve.
No. You're the goddess of locality. I can tell you that.
Oh
right
no.
Now. Oh yes.
I think. Well.
Is he still a local?
I think so, yeah.
Okay. Whew. I was worried she was going to take that away from me.
I wasn't going to take it back. I was going to explain a little bit more, but
okay, no, I want to hear it. I want to hear it. He's from California. He's got computer loot, and he's given back to the community for all this time.
Yeah.
And you gave him you put the medal, the local medal around his neck.
I think he should have that though. You know, he's still putting back into the community.
I think
it's not
Steve
like he's just sitting
that.
There.
We should have like a little medal.
We just need some kind of ceremony to make him feel like he's reached that point of being a part of the community.
I'm just underscoring that our beautiful town here has a lot of folks that make up the fabric that come from a lot of different places.
From all different places.
Yes, and what brings us together is what. I love the place. I can say that. I just love the place.
I can tell you this from that perspective. And in my when I was in the geek world, I traveled the world, went all over the world and did stuff. And family, I'm telling you, deep down at the bottom, family permeates everything. I don't care if it's Taiwan, China, Japan, Greek, Germany, all that. When you get to really talk to people, the love and the humanity is beautiful. And it's just that small percentage that whack it out and get all the attention. And so...
I think we got a lot of folks here in St. Helens, which is why the radio show exists. It's because I've run into a few gin joints here and there. And I've met some folks. What fascinates me is the depth of the people that live here. Everybody's got a backstory. And that's what we're going to try and talk a little bit more about. We're going to meet some of our neighbors, Kim. That's the objective of this show. What do you think about that?
Well, I wore my Mr. Rogers neighborhood sweater today, so.
Okay. I was going to ask Danny to play any kind of thing. Let me see. One more thing. How about Sweet Caroline? Can we do that?
He knows that one. Yeah. I know he knows that one.
I'm trying to say, okay, how about I'm a believer? I'm a believer for all the Ducks fans that we are. I know everyone's like thinking. How's it start out?
Love was only true in fairy
tales. Almost wrapping up here.
We got a minute.
1 minute.
That went by fast.
Well, I got to say this: that I am a believer in when you walk into the place and they got the piano guy there, it's gonna be a good time. That's what I say.
23rd, he'll be playing at the Klondike.
At the Klondike.
Come listen to some lovely music, have some good cocktails, eat some good food.
And I'm not sure. I go with the flow, but if you can sing, come on in to the Klondike.
That's right. And Linda's coming back in. Linda, how are we doing on the clam chowder? It's almost sold out.
Is it 86 yet?
Yes. So Danny, thank you so much. Anything you want to add before we sign off here on?
I guess the only thing I'd like to say is thanks for a great community. I feel some really positive forward movement, especially the last couple of years. And especially since after COVID, it seems like everything's coming back to life again.
Yeah.
It's great. And the restaurant is full. I can hear them.
Yeah.
It's Friday night. We're about to turn the game on here.
I'm going to put my apron on and get to work.
I know. We're going to have to make sure that people, But Danny, stay, and I think we will have a planned food fight later, and I really want you to be firing up the piano music for the food fight so that those kids can be, the mini pies and the clam chowder.
Maybe
in
some,
the bowls,
like, mashed potatoes would be good.
Yep. Uh-oh, here we go. The kids are big. Put that down. Oh, oh my. They're coming. Oh, my God. They're coming at us.
You've been listening to the St. Helens Town Talk Cafe with Steve Toski. Address your comments to KOHI.radio@gmail.com and listen again at 4 o'clock Monday through Friday for St. Helens Town Talk Cafe here on KOHI.